Good evening, everyone. My name is Nadine Smith. I am the proud principal of the historic Paul Lawrence Dunbar High School. I'd like to welcome all of you to our very first ever virtual back to school night. This is a very special year at Dunbar. This year, we celebrate 150 years of Dunbar excellence. Our theme this year, the marathon continues.
Welcome to the Dunbar Engineering Academy. My name is Courtney Perm, and I am the Engineering Academy Director. The vision of the Dunbar Engineering Academy is that engineers are the greatest change agents for a change in our society. They turn research and theory into tangible reality. The machines, tools, and systems that define the modern world. An investment in the encouragement and education of tomorrow's engineers is an investment in a brighter future for us all. The Charles R. Drew Engineering Academy at Paul Lawrence Dunbar High School here in Washington, D.C. is a breeding ground for young engineers, a place where we can work together to make the world a better place, one child at a time. Our mission is simple. We want to support the development of future engineers with a rigorous curriculum, engaging classroom instruction, a coordinated set of relevant activities, individualized academic and behavioral intervention, and a consistent focus on career readiness through our work-based learning continuum, exposure to industry professionals, mentoring, and opportunities for internships. The DA student is expected to be dedicated, honorable, and scholarly. These three adjectives are very important to the core of a Dunbar Engineering Academy student. Student expectations. Students in the Engineering Academy are expected to represent the Academy by attending school daily and on time. Yes, even in a virtual space. Participate in tutoring and at least one extracurricular activity. This can include sports. Interact positively and cooperatively with all peers and adults. Encourage peers to strive for academic excellence, for example, taking assessments and completing projects. Participate in work-based learning activities in order to become future ready. Parent expectations. Yes, in the Dunbar Engineering Academy, we have expectations for our parents. We ask that you assist your child with setting and accomplishing personal goals. Work collaboratively with the DEA team. Examples include attending parent meetings that we have and will continue to have in a virtual space every other week, and PTSA meetings. Use technology as a tool of effective communication. Fresh Schools is our main communication source, and we ask that you check it regularly. And most importantly, completing paperwork on time, such as permission slips. Work-based learning. Dunbar Engineering Academy aspires to be a program where students are challenged to think critically and where teachers provide students with authentic learning experiences in a trusted and collaborative environment. Our work-based learning continuum can be seen in this diagram. It is broken down into awareness, exploration, and preparedness. Under each category, you'll see some of the activities that we provide to fit that part of the work-based learning continuum. One thing that is consistent and has been consistent is that we are preparing students to be future ready, and it ends in an internship experience. Every student must leave the Engineering Academy with an internship experience. So, certifications. NAVTRAC certification is what our students strive to achieve. There are three components to achieving NAVTRAC certification. One is completing the career coursework, meaning your child is taking one engineering class each year. The second is completing a qualifying internship, a minimum of 120 hours at a paid and highly qualified internship experience. You can also split that up into two 60-hour internships, but it must be done prior to graduation. And most importantly, high school graduation. And I know that may seem interesting to ask why high school graduation, but some students are really, really good at their craft. And so we want to make sure that they don't just move on to the apprenticeship portion, but they complete high school and then move into the future ready track. College preparation, monthly college visits, work-based learning retreats, SAT prep class, the PSAT test, project-based learning, for example, our mandatory STEM fair, and scholarship opportunities. This is how we prepare our Engineering Academy students for college. Career preparation. Every student has to have a career. So we prepare them by hosting resume workshops, mandatory mock interviews, employability skills training in a course called Tenacity, and other activities such as job shadow day and job site tours. Our major work-based learning events this year will include mandatory participation in the 2021 Dunbar Virtual STEM Fair that'll be held on February 10th, 2021, participation in the 2021 Groundhog Job Shadow Day for the upper grades, it'll be December 11th of this year, and for the lower grades, it'll be December 2nd of next year. We will also bring back the Amazon Future Engineers program with the Intro to Computer Science class. Dr. Johnson will be teaching that course on Wednesday, so it's another opportunity to give our students an extra notch on their resume. We have resume workshops scheduled for the spring and monthly virtual college tours. Groundhog Job Shadow Day. This is mandatory for all 9th and 10th grade students in February, and it is also mandatory for the 11th and 12th grade students, which will be held in December. Students would submit a professional picture from their site, and students should also complete a post-job shadow day survey. So this is how we ensure that the students are completing the experience, and this is also how we continue to brand the job shadow day experience for Dunbar. So feel free to follow us on Twitter to see some of our previous job shadow day experiences. Mock interview day will be held on March 17, 2021 from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. This is a mandatory event every year for all DEA students. Yes, grades 9 through 12. Students should be dressed in business attire. This is the kickoff event for our internship interviews, which are held every spring. Just in case you were wondering what business attire looks like as you start to prepare to shop for the holiday season, it looks something similar to this. A coat, slacks or skirt, dress shoes for males or females. So yes, we want the students to come to school fully ready to prepare for internship season. Academy activities include robotics, Team 2961, Go Team 2961, ACE Mentors, Architecture, Construction, and Engineers come every other Wednesday, and they still will continue to work with the students in a virtual space to prepare our students who are interested in those career fields. Women in Transportation, they take on the great task of working with our younger female students and exposing them to STEM. SAT exam held for the seniors on October 14th, And we are bringing back the electric vehicle competitions. So Roll Tide, we are looking for all students who are fast and furious, and they want to build the next Dunbar electric vehicle.
Welcome to the Eleanor Holmes Norton Law and Public Policy Academy. We would like to take a moment of silence for our alumni, Mr. Richard Bangora, Mr. Law and Public Policy himself. He will greatly be missed. Our mission, we want to nurture students who are actively involved in their community, using their voice to affect change. We have a goal of producing socially aware citizens who are ready and waiting to make a difference in the world. Why do we do what we do? Why are we here as an academy? We teach our students how to use their voice. We teach our students that they can make change. We want them to know their rights, and we want to empower them so that they can learn from their experiences instead of being punished by them. We try to prepare them with critical thinking skills, and then we want them to be mentally and socially prepared for life after high school. Any students who are interested in law, who are curious about what we do in the government, any students who are student leaders or activists, or they don't mind speaking up, students that love to collaborate with others on service projects and competitions, if they're interested in internships and field trips to law-related places, and just having a career path in law or justice, this is the academy for them. Our academy is set apart from the other academies because of our specialty. We work hard to give our students a voice. We work hard to ensure our students can make change in and out of our community. We involve students in experiential learning, such as moot courts and mock trials. We have various guest speakers, including lawyers and authors and entrepreneurs and other individuals that are in the community making changes. We also have started a peer court program. And many of our students have been recognized nationally and locally in competitions and in programming. We promise to partner with local law schools, businesses, firms, and other organizations to expose our students to the knowledge that they can get from these individuals. We also include a comprehensive program of these specialty courses that we offer here at Dunbar. And just having a real world experience, so that experiential learning, mock trials and presentations and college tours, we offer that to our students. Our belief in maximizing student voice. You can see the array of opportunities that our students have had over the years, from being a published author with the Huffington Post to actually winning a national competition and getting a free trip to San Francisco to meet with other students from around the country, from winning a $4,000 grant to use for our academy to starting a peer court program at our school. Speaking of our peer court program, we are utilizing the principles of restorative justice, responsibility, student empowerment, and leadership. And our simple focus is just to restore the harm done to our community through service. So students actually make up the peer court and they make the decisions. Our upcoming events for the month of October and November. We are specifically focusing on the election this year, because this is a very important election, please reach out to DunbarLPP@gmail.com to get on our mailing list so that we can send you newsletters and other announcements. Lastly, we urge you to vote on November the 3rd. You can go to our website, dunbarlpp.org, and click the link to register to vote. Here are important dates for you. And lastly, our partners in law. We thank these individuals and organizations for sponsoring us with different experiences for our students. Have a great evening. Please take care.
Good evening. My name is Douglas Jacobs, and I'm the director of the Dunbar Sports Management Academy here at Dunbar Senior High School, which is also known as the House of Champions. The mission of the Dunbar Sports Management Academy is to empower students with the skills, knowledge, and experiences required for an exciting career in the world of sports. The vision of the Dunbar Sports Management Academy is to promote student success by providing a collaborative learning environment along with a career-focused curriculum to create post-secondary educational and employment opportunities for students. The Dunbar Sports Management Academy was created by Principal Smith for school year 2019-2020 to provide an opportunity for students who were naturally interested in sports and entertainment to engage academically, with the thought being that students who were naturally interested in the topic would perform better in the classroom. The current course offering includes a Sports Management 1 course, a Sports Management 2 course, and various health and physical education courses that are embedded as well. A little bit about my background. I'm originally from Camden, Arkansas. I'm a Howard University School of Business graduate. I have over 20 years in public education. During that 20-year period, I've coached over seven different sports at the high school level. I also have NCAA Division II basketball coaching experience, and I've also taught over 20 different business courses that include, but are not limited to, marketing, entrepreneurship, economics, retailing, management, and also financial planning. In terms of the course content overview for the academy, some of the topics that we discuss include marketing promotion, management, advertising, sponsorships, social responsibility and philanthropy, and also the legal structures of business. What we strive to do as an academy is identify students who are interested and have a passion for the business of sports and entertainment. We invest a lot of time, energy, and effort in community networking to enhance the scholars' learning experience, which we hope in turn provides more insight, more connections, and more engagement for the students. We also inspire students that we can impact in a positive manner to have a profound impact on them to pursue the dreams that define their lives. Academies are structured so that they have advisory boards and partners, and the basic purpose of the advisory board is to provide the school an assistance with student recruitment by meeting and addressing student candidates and their parents, in some cases by providing promotional materials to the school and different school events, and generally advocating on behalf of the academy in the business sector and at various social activities throughout the city as well. And we're blessed to have four quality individuals as a part of our academy. The next four slides will give you some basic information about those individuals. Those individuals are Mr. Cameron Moore, Mr. Justin Faust, Mr. Malik Vanderpool, and Mr. Leonard Stevens. Mr. Cameron Moore is a recent graduate of Herndon High School located in Virginia, class of 2018. He's currently enrolled as a sports management major at the University of Amherst, the University of Massachusetts in Amherst. It should be noted that the University of Massachusetts at Amherst is one of the top 10 sports management programs in the United States. Mr. Moore's plans after graduation are to obtain an entry-level consultant position in the National Basketball Association and ultimately own his own sports marketing firm. Mr. Justin Faust is the owner of a personal training company called Acme Personal Training. Mr. Faust is originally from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. While at Howard University, Mr. Faust studied broadcast journalism and also played football for the university from 2003 to 2007. In addition to running Acme Personal Training, Mr. Faust is also a real estate investor. Mr. Malik Vanderpool is the owner of MVP Fitness and Massage. Mr. Vanderpool originally is from Brooklyn, New York. He's a proud graduate of the Elizabeth City State University, where he studied finance. And prior to running MVP Fitness and Massage, Mr. Vanderpool was a former FDIC executive, and he's a current real estate investor as well. Lastly, we have Mr. Leonard Stevens, who is the owner of Perfect Performance. Perfect Performance is a company that trains college athletes to perform at an optimal level. Mr. Stevens is from Miami, Florida. He's a proud graduate of Howard University, where he was a marketing major. Mr. Stevens played football for Howard from 1996 to 2000. Also, Mr. Stevens is a former investment banker and spent 6 years in the National Football League as a player with 5 different teams. In terms of the academy experiences that we offer for students, there are two that we're going to highlight. One is the sports business seminar that's hosted every year by Monumental Sports. And Monumental Sports is the organization that owns the Washington Wizards and the Washington Capitals. At this particular event, they have a college fair that features over 50 colleges and universities from around the area. And they also have different executives that work for the sports teams. And those particular executives basically share with students the preparation needed for potential careers in sports. And they discuss how they got their start in the sports and entertainment industry. The capstone experience that we have for the Dunbar Sports Management Academy is basically the Howard University Sports and Entertainment Summit. Last year, we were very fortunate and blessed to be the only high school that was in attendance at this particular event that was held on the campus of Howard University. It's an annual event that basically aims to introduce young students and aspiring business professionals to the opportunities that exist within the business, within the sports and entertainment industries. During this event, there's a variety of industry professionals from the top companies in sports, including Major League Baseball, the National Football League, Octagon, NASCAR, the National Basketball Association, and the Maybach Music Group. Those industry professionals were there to discuss important issues and topics that are relevant to their specific industries. While at the event, the students as well as myself had an opportunity to network and meet some dynamic business professionals. The next two slides highlight who those individuals are. Mr. Johnny London, sales manager for the Washington Wizards. Ms. Cara Adams, manager guest experiences for the Washington Nationals, also a Howard University graduate. Mr. Kelvin Scott, director of human resources, Washington Nationals. Ms. Kelly Evans, editor for The Undefeated, which is a digital publication that's owned by ESPN. Ms. Asia Golston, manager of integrated sales and marketing for the National Football League. And lastly, Mr. Kasim Peterson, who's the director of digital marketing for the Maybach Music Group. Mr. Peterson is also from Petersburg, Virginia. Several of these individuals were in contact with me during the last school year and had planned to come out to the school to deliver presentations to the students. But unfortunately, that was interrupted by this COVID experience. But we look forward to networking and reconnecting with these executives once this COVID thing gets under control, so that the students can have an opportunity to network with them and identify what they need to do to prepare to be as successful as they are. In terms of the skill development for the academy, we basically focus on 3 areas. Academic skills, which focuses on the content knowledge in terms of learning the core business principles as they relate to sports and entertainment. Personal management skills, how students are able to manage themselves, negotiate, public speaking. Last but not least, we have teamwork skills. The teamwork skills focus on the ability for students to work together as a team. Most of the jobs in professional sports and entertainment are structured based on teams and departments, so we hope that the preparation at the high school level prepares students for what that looks like on a professional level. Why sports management? These comments come directly from one of our board members, Mr. Cameron Moore. And speaking with Mr. Moore, he basically shared with me that he chose to study sports management so that he could gain a holistic education on the sports industry and understand why that business operates differently from other industries. Recently, he said that he declared a second major in business administration while at the University of Massachusetts at Amherst so that he could center his focus on the business environment to give him more of a competitive advantage that will hopefully help him secure a consulting position in the National Basketball Association once he graduates. This just about wraps up the presentation as it relates to the Sports Management Academy here at Dunbar Senior High School. I appreciate you guys taking the time to view the PowerPoint. And as my closing remarks, remember that as we all experience an unprecedented time in the world, always remember that the marathon continues because the race is never over. Thank you in advance for your support of the Dunbar Sports Management Academy. For additional questions or if you are interested in joining the marathon, please contact me at the email address listed below, douglas.jacobs@k12.dc.gov. Enjoy your evening
and roll tide.
Hi everyone, on behalf of the Carter G. Woodson Academy of Black Studies, I'd like to welcome you to Dunbar's Back to School Night 2020. Today, I wanted to give you a brief introduction to the work we do as one of the four academies at Dunbar High School. Although this is only our second year, we have accomplished a lot and we're so excited to share a bit about the work we do as a Black Studies family. First, let's start with our team. Our team comprises of a whole community of people. Let's start with our team of educators. On the far left, we have our fearless leader and principal, Nadine Smith, followed by Mr. Calhoun, who is a longtime educator at Dunbar. Next to him, we have Mr. Jackson. Mr. Jackson is our amazing art educator and art expert, and he integrates what he does into the work of Black Studies. We have Ms. Collins, who is also a phenomenal educator. And this year we actually have Ms. Glasgow, Ms. Mitchell, Mr. Robinson, and last but not least, we have myself, Ms. Karima Rogers. I am the director of the Carter G. Woodson Academy of Black Studies. Next, let's talk a little bit about our heartbeat, our why we're here and who we do it for, our students. We currently have 142 Black Studies students that are a part of this academy. And they are who we work hard for, and they are who this academy is for. And last but not least, we have our community partners. We have a number of community partners. We have here the Mayor's Office of African American Affairs. We also have our longtime partner, Sankofa Video and Bookstore. We have Asala, another one of our phenomenal partners, which was an organization founded by Carter G. Woodson himself. And we also have Howard University. And last but not least, we have the Dunbar Alumni Federation. So to start off, let's do a quick activity called Thumbs Up. I'm going to read a statement. If this was your experience in high school or middle school, if you are a current student, I want you to put a thumbs up. If this was not your experience or only was sometimes your experience, I want you to put a thumbs down. All right, let's get started. If you learned a lot about Black history in your high school outside of Black History Month, go ahead and put a thumbs up. If this was not your experience or only sometimes your experience, I want you to put a thumbs down. Let's look at the second statement. What you learned in high school affirmed who you are and countered negative images and stereotypes that may exist about you. Put a thumbs up if this applies to your experience and a thumbs down if it didn't. Next, you felt like you had a smaller community within your high school that you felt connected to and a part of. Thumbs up or thumbs down. Last but not least, you were regularly empowered and encouraged to make changes that negatively impacted your community or oppressed populations. Thumbs up if you were regularly empowered and encouraged to make change. Thumbs down if that was not your experience. Well, I hope many of you had a thumbs up, but if your experience was like my experience and like many others' experiences across the country, you probably had a lot of thumbs down on that previous activity. But here's the thing. We don't want this to be the reality for our students at Dunbar. Our beliefs are that we know Black Lives Matter and Black Studies matter. We believe that learning about and celebrating one history and culture is important to the development of identity and sense of self. We believe in the importance of community and that we are stronger together. And last but not least, we believe, like Carter G. Woodson, that real education means to learn to begin with life as you find it and make it better. And then armed with knowledge, our students will change the world and end systemic oppression. These are some of our beliefs, and this is why we do what we do as an academy. So what does that all look like in practice? Well, outside of taking 7 different courses rooted in learning about our history or one's history and celebrating it, we also have some pretty dope experiences for our students and staff. Let's take a walk down memory lane using last year's events. The first picture you'll see is a picture from the Black Shirt Ceremony that we had. This is our official welcoming and induction into the academy. Students get their first Black Studies shirt and they make commitments to the work of Black Studies. We also had a Smart, Dope, and Black event. This is like a celebration. There are performances, there's trivia, and there's excitement. So we try to do at least 2 of those every year. We have guest speakers such as when Black Lives Matter, their DC chapter came in, talked about the work they do, had a discussion with the students, all before everything went down this year. We had a diving into Black history scuba experience. This was a really exciting event. During this event, Diving with a Purpose came in and they talked about the work they do to excavate slave ship ruins. They actually found that piece that is at in the basement at the African American History Museum. There's a piece of a slave ship. They found that piece. So they talked about the work that they do. And they also took students down to the Dunbar pool, put equipment on them, and let them learn different scuba diving techniques. If your student is a part of this academy, they'll probably take African American literature. And during this time, they'll do a mock trial. This mock trial will be based on a book such as Their Eyes Are Watching God. And students will work with Howard University law students as well as current practicing lawyers, such as lawyers at the Office of the Attorney General. And they will work to prepare to put on a mock trial and play different roles in this mock trial. So here's a picture of that. And then we also just have a number of events. This was, for example, from the National Negro League Centennial. We had a number of Hall of Fame baseball players come and talk about the history of like why they exist in the first place and just informed and educated the students about it. Well, I'd love to talk to you more about all that we do, but this was just a preview. So here are some upcoming events for Black Studies families and when you'll learn more about all the fabulous things we're planning for you this year. First up, October 6th, we're having our first official Black Studies students meeting. So if you are a Black Studies student, you know where you need to be October 6th. Also, we have a cool event coming up on October 8th. It is a community discussion. We'll have a guest speaker, filmmaker, Marawi Garima, and he will be showing us or discussing with us his film, Residue. And then last but not least, we have on October 9th, a parent-teacher conference day, which is for the whole school, but we are having a Black Studies Academy parent meeting, and it's our first one. It's at 5 p.m., and during this time, we'll go over all of the dope events we have planned for our students. We hope to see you all there, and if you'd like to follow our journey as a Black Studies Academy, please feel free to check us out on Twitter and Instagram at DHS Black Studies. Thank you. Bye.
My name is Faith. I'm a senior here at Dunbar High School, and I'm a part of the Black Studies Academy. Now, today you're going to learn a little bit more history about Dunbar High School, and we're going to take you on a tour of the building. Let's go!
first public school for African Americans. I'll show you more information about Dunbar and the Dunbar Now. Follow me. Over here is one of the first Dunbar Senior High School models that was originated from 1872 to 1877, which was called the Charles Summer School. Over here is another location of Dunbar High School, which is called the Inner Street High School, which was one of the fifth locations used from 1891 to 1916. And then if you go over here, it's another model of one of our buildings back in the day, which is called Brick from 1916 building. And then over here is one of our most recent models, which is originated from 1977 to 2013, which is called Paul Lawrence Dunbar High School. And then if you go over here, it's our trophy case where most of our sports back in the day won track medals, we won.
Special guests come, and last year we had an event called Smart, Dope, and Black. That was put on by the Black Studies Academy here at Dunbar High School. Welcome to Dunbar School.
Events. In the back we have stamps of alumni, and you can also come here to study.
Thank you for joining us on tour today. We hope that you learned a bit about our history and got a glimpse of our beautiful building. Until next time.
Welcome, parents, teachers, staff, and students to our back to school night. This evening, we are excited to present to you the TIDES Advisory Program. TIDES stand for Thoughtfully Impacting and Developing Excellent Students. My name is Dr. Cox and Dr. Palmer. We will be presenting this program for you this afternoon.
So why did we want to start the TIDES program this year? So here it says, every kid is one caring adult away from being a success story. And we strongly believe that at Dunbar. So we are known for celebrating 150 years of academic excellence. And this year we really wanted to hone in on helping expand our students' social emotional skills in the same way that we expand their academic skills. We felt that it was important for our students to be college and career ready post-graduation, that they not only have strong reading, writing, and math skills, but they also have strong social emotional skills to help them deal with the different aspects of life that they encounter on a daily basis.
So we got together with a group of professionals here at Dunbar that are called the SEL Squad. And we develop our SEL, Dunbar SEL model. Our Dunbar SEL model brings together the CASEL model and what we call our TIDES program. So for CASEL, the five components that drive their model is self-awareness, self-management, responsible decision-making, relationship skills, and social awareness. So from these, we developed our model that is targeting, that's going to target our students. We wanted to make sure this program was relevant to the Dunbar student community, and it was also culturally appropriate for our students. So we have under self-awareness, we're going to be working with them on self-esteem and self-advocacy. We are also going to work with them under self-management on self-regulation skills and motivation. In addition, we are going to work with them under responsible decision-making, goal setting, and conflict resolution. And we're also going to help develop skills such as relationship skills, where we're going to work with them on building trust and communication. And lastly, the other component under the CASEL model that we have developed is civic responsibility and social justice.
Each of these, each month will represent a different theme, and each topic for the Dunbar model will represent that month. So we wanted to give you an opportunity to see what this could look like in practice. There's a lot of research that talks about the benefits of social emotional learning classes in schools and how it can support kids with academic growth and their social emotional growth. So we wanted to let you see this in action. So we're going to watch a short video of the Chicago school, all boys school in Chicago.
How are you, sir? Good morning. Good morning, sir. Good morning.
I believe there is a correlation between bullying and stress. For example, when someone is being bullied, they might lose sleep because they're stressed about it.
Absolutely. What are you willing to do to foster more of an anti-bullying culture here at Urban Prep?
100% cause acceptance rate is a direct result of our pride periods. We focus on building them character-wise and building their social and emotional skills.
Really difficult to ask a young man to sit and focus in a biology class if they're hungry, if they're worried about where their mom is, if they're worried about coming to and from school and they have to cross gang lines. When they come to pride class, the idea is that this is a relaxing environment where they can talk about issues that they're facing and also leave with skills every day to help them better navigate their situations in school and outside of school. What we're gonna do today, gentlemen, is actually go through a few activities so that we can know the difference between positive peer interaction and bullying.
Each of our students is placed when they're freshmen in a group that we call Pride. We're Urban Prep Lions and Lions travel in Prides. And so we have our students grouped according to Prides and they meet in their Prides every day.
You're with them from like freshman year to senior year. So it creates more of a connection to where these are like actually my brothers, people that I can lean on if I need something.
We all had to apologize because that we weren't trying to make them feel
I don't want it.
Give yourselves a hand. Let's give it up for God. Great job, baby.
We have 4 pride leaders, and so 1 pride leader represents each grade level. Essentially, we're kind of like a grade level counselor for them. The one person in the building that will remain consistent from freshman year until graduation, that will know about their familial situations, know about challenges that they've had academically.
How has the environment that you have been in affected you?
Where I used to live, people around me, like, set a bad example, so I used to follow kinda, and I didn't really work hard.
But what does a positive environment look like to you?
Positive people, because people really make up the environment, actually. It's the way that people react to each other and treat each other and show respect.
So respect.
So relationships are the cornerstone of pride. The young men are able to develop a bond with their brothers and their pride families, as well as with an adult in the building. All of the pride leaders have a background or a degree in the field of social work.
Last year, when I was having problems with my father, Mr. Moore, he came to me because he noticed that I had problems.
Pride leaders can provide them not just with an ear, but with a toolkit on how to deal with these things.
We have a framework full of topics and ideas for our lesson plans for the week. Anything from safe sex practices, college preparedness and awareness, stress.
Explain one thing you learned about stress from this week's discussion.
And remember, do not write your name on it. I asked them, what should you do with stress? And they said, get rid of it. And then they balled up the paper. So let's get rid of the stress.
Go!
We're able to have fun, laugh, be loud, so that we can actually have that discussion about stress.
Everybody have a snowball. All right, so open them up, and let's see what we've learned.
This person said, I've learned that stress affects how much you eat a day.
Sometimes stress could give you some type of body pain.
One thing I learned is that I should be able to feel good about myself in order to prevent stress. I believe that I haven't felt good about myself in such a long time, and that I think that is a problem for me.
As social workers, we also are given the autonomy to address the specific needs of our students. If I had come in class today prepared to do an activity regarding stress, but there had been some community violence issues that arose last night, then that's what we would focus on for that class period.
Many of y'all know that I had a brother that passed in February due to gun violence. I had to make a decision. Do I make this anger constructive or destructive?
By facing these issues that many of them try to suppress, we bring them face to face with them so that we can talk about ways to deal with these type of things.
Constructive anger seems like it would mean I'm so angry that this violence is going on, so I'm gonna go out here and stop it. It puts a passion to your heart to the point where you don't wanna quit. Mm-hmm. But destructive anger makes you feel like I don't care. Going to Pride every day does something for me that no academic class could do. It's like a second home to come in and be able to talk about anything, so I don't have to hold things in all day long.
What is something that angers you all about society?
You can't be judged after like who you are or your character. People just judge you off of your race, your gender, the community you live in.
When a person tries to change their gender, they treat it like a monster. That's my thing.
Yeah. If I get angry, I can just think of prior class and Mr. Sashington's words, and it may calm me down.
If we really care about academic development, we have to care about social emotional development. You can't have one without the other. Our students, through our prior program and through the fact that we provide them with those non-college skill development, they're able to apply to college, be accepted, and then once they get there, they persist.
There's no limits to how many things you could do if somebody is believing in you.
Thank you. So when you have that support system, right?
Yeah.
Share this video because we really love how this highlights really what an advisory program can be for students. As you heard some of the students' name as well as the teachers in this video, advisory has really become a safe space for a lot of these students to process things that are going through on a daily basis. And also learn and take away skills that they can apply in these different situations. And we really hope that that's what the TIDES program can be for our students here at Dunbar. And we are excited to offer this to all students so that they can have this safe space. And that teacher, you heard a student say, like, if you have that person that believes in you and really supports you, that you can kind of do anything. And we're really trying to create that environment with the TIDES program here at Dunbar. Wanted to play for you again. So what will the students be learning, and what does the scope and sequence and logistics look like for the program? So for the TIDES program, again, each month is broken down to a specific area. So you'll see on the month, and then you'll see the Dunbar specific area, and then what castle model that relates to. So for September, we really focused on building trust. So your students were receiving calls from the advisor, just introducing themselves and getting to know one another. And then we start with our part one, and just kind of helping students understand what TIDES is and why we're having TIDES class. We'll move on to October, where we'll go into self-regulation. November, we'll focus on conflict resolution. And December, we'll focus on goal setting. As you can see, each week, students are exposed to a different area under each one of those skills, where we're taking that larger skill area and breaking it down into smaller pieces and providing the tools that they need to be successful in that area. We'll continue this throughout the year. So January, we'll come back strong from our holiday break and focus on motivation and getting students back into the swing of things. February, we'll focus on self-esteem. March, communication. April, self-advocacy. And May, civic responsibility. And in June, we'll do a culminating activity within the advisory groups that will kind of pull together all the information and knowledge that they've learned across the school year.
So we wanted to give you guys a better understanding of the logistics that's involved and the student expectations that's involved in our TIDES advisory program. So the way the program is going to work is it's going to be delivered on a weekly basis. However, there will only be two synchronous lessons, which are delivered directly from their advisors, and two asynchronous lessons, which the student will be participate in virtually. So it will be every single Wednesday at 1:10 to 2 p.m. On those Wednesdays, we are expecting that students will log on to their TIDES group and participate in the activity that is being presented either by their advisor, or they are participating in the asynchronous lesson. The way that we divided our TIDES groups up were by grade level, academies, and or special education. So the students are required to attend their weekly TIDES group, as stated before. And although this is going to be a non-graded advisory, we do want the students to fully participate in this program, because it is not just about getting a grade, it's also about building skills that's going to last them a lifetime.
So on Wednesdays, when students to access their TIDES class, they attend TIDES class the same way they attend any other class. So they will go to their Canvas page, and from there log in for attendance purposes, because again, attendance is mandatory on Wednesdays as well, and then they'll follow the link to their TIDES class. On the asynchronous days, their TIDES advisor will post the lesson for them to follow step by step how to complete the lesson and post the response to that day's lesson.
So we wanted to leave you all with this quote by a really famous educator, Rita Pearson. She says, "Every child deserves a champion, an adult who will never give up on them, who understands the power of connection and insists that they become the best that they can possibly be." And that's what we are aiming to do here, to allow our students to know that we are not going to give up on them, that we are going to be a champion for them, and that we want to connect with them in a powerful way that's going to help them build skills not for just in school, but skills that they're going to need in life. So we want to thank you very much for listening to this, and we're excited about the Tides program, and we cannot wait to have our students and our teachers and our staff involved in this program.
If you have any questions about the Tides program, or where your students should be, or what's happening in Tides advisory, this is just the information for all the SEL squad members. So again, all members of the squad have worked really hard since last year to put this program together. And so anyone presented here can be contacted to answer any questions that you have about the Tides program. So again, as Dr. Cox said, thank you very much for taking time to listen to our presentation. And we hope you're just as excited as we are to start the Tides Advisory Program and help our students grow their social emotional skills. Have a good night.
Friends, happy back to school night. This is Ms. Smith from the attendance office and team, and we would like to bring to you some policies and protocols from Dunbar. Attendance matters every day at Dunbar, including Wednesdays, so please remind your students to log into Canvas every Wednesday. Please be sure to sign into Canvas daily, Monday through Friday. Next slide. So let's introduce the attendance team for 2021. It's the attendance counselors and officers and our admin advisor assistants. Myself, Ms. Smith, I am the point of contact for the 12th grade upper school. We have Mr. Donovan Livingston, the point of contact for 10th grade. Ms. Wiggins, the point of contact for 11th grade, and Ms. Douglas, the point of contact for the 9th grade. We also have Mr. Buttram, Ms. Sedgwick, AP Goodman, and Mr. Boyd, who supports our team. Next slide. What does it mean to attend virtually? Virtual attendance this year will not be the same as it ended off last year when we first started virtual learning. So we will be treating virtual learning this year, this term, as regular school. So it is compulsory. It is by law that students attend our virtual learning every day as required. Students will be considered present for the day if they log into Canvas at least once between 6 a.m. and 11:59 each day. Course attendance will not be taken. Next slide. So for any instance that students are experiencing technical issues, we want to assure that students who are experiencing technical issues are still completing and that are
to completing their schoolwork are not considered absent for the day. So if you are experiencing these technical difficulties, students and families, please reach out to your attendance point of contact, and we will put in our CDP code for confirming virtual presence for each student. Next slide. What's the difference? So from in-person instruction to virtual instruction. For virtual instruction, attendance will be recorded based on a student logging into Canvas each day. So that attendance will be taken each time student logs into Canvas each day, including Wednesdays, between 6 a.m. and 11:59 p.m. Canvas participation will transfer to a student's Aspen attendance records on a daily basis. So each time a student logs in, Canvas will transfer that information over to Aspen, and it will be available to all those who have Aspen accounts. Next slide. What policies have changed to accommodate virtual learning? Grading and retention. So course failure will not be associated with attendance. I mentioned earlier that there will be no course attendance or class attendance that we called it. So logging into Canvas daily will be the only way that students will be counted for attendance each day. So there is no more 80-20 for virtual term. It will resume when we go back to school in the building, but for our virtual learning, there will be no 80-20 or course attendance. So you will be only accounted for by logging into Canvas each day. This also lets you know that there will not be that 30-day failure, no FA for students also while we're in the virtual term. Attendance protocol and requirements, 3-day letters, addition to the wellness check. So we will now be doing wellness checks in replace of the 3-day letters. Note submission requirement. Notes may be submitted electronically to family from families. We will also let you know who to send those notes to and the best ways to contact us. And the immunization policy will take place when we return back to school. So it's not to be worried about while we are in virtual learning. Next slide. Key metrics, key attendance metrics. So these are some important terms that we use in attendance, and you will hear them often, which is the in-seat attendance rate, the truancy rate, and the chronic absent rate. In-seat attendance is something that DCPS refer as butts in seats, meaning that the students are in school, in class. In this virtual setting, it will be students are logged into Canvas. The percentage of days attended the days that they're enrolled by a student or group or student. So those days are included both excused and unexcused absences. The truancy rate once a student secured 10 or more unexcused absences in a given school year, you are considered truant. And the chronic absent rate is 10% of the school year excused or unexcused absences, meaning if you are 10% absent out of just 6 months or 10% absent out of the whole school year. Next slide. 2020-21 attendance protocols. So I mentioned that we will be doing a wellness check, phone calls to identify any technical barriers or other challenges once students reach 3 absences. So instead of sending out that letter, we are going to try to reach out to all families as soon as possible, given the amount of students we have, to assure that everything is doing everything is going well or any issues that happen, and check up on those students who are just getting those absences. After that, we will send out a universal letter. And those who do not have the email on file will receive a letter in the mail once the student reached 5 unexcused absences. Then after following the 5-day absences, we will send out the 7-day MPD warning letter to parents. This is to let parents know that, you know, students have missed 7 days, which is about 2 weeks out of school. Almost 2 weeks out of school, excuse me. And we want to let you all know that that this is happening and we want to start to take action. 10 unexcused absences, which is that 2-week mark, those universal letters will be sent out as well. Once a student reach 15 absences, they are to be referred to a court social services. We want to assure that that does not get to that point. So let's make sure that we are responding to these messages when we get them. And those court referrals are for ages 14 to 17. And then we have that 20-day consecutive mark. Next slide.
Greetings, Dunbar family. My name is Mr. Livingston. I will be covering some key attendance policies. Parents have 5 school days after a student returns from an absence to turn in an excuse note. This includes all type of notes, including doctor's notes, and the note should be sent in as quickly as possible to avoid us not being able to change the absence within 48 hours. Also, a doctor's note or other supporting documentation beyond a parent note is required after the 4th absence within a term. Now I would like to give some examples of excused absences. These excused absences include student illness with a doctor's note or other documentation if a student is absent for 5 or more days within a term, death in a student's immediate family, if a student has to make a court appearance, observance of a religious holiday, the illness of a child for parenting students, along with a doctor's note for more than 5 days within a term, a medical or dental appointment, a religious event or celebration outside of a religious holiday, up to a total of 5 days per year, and college visits for up to 3 days in a school year. So how should we submit our notes? All absent excuse letters should be submitted directly to the attendance team to avoid lost notes. If you are part of the lower school academy, a 9th or a 10th grader, all excuse notes should be sent to myself, Mr. Livingston. My email address is donovan.livingston@k12.dc.gov. Or you can send your excuse notes to my cell phone. The number is 202-794-3569. If you are a part of the upper school academy, meaning an 11th or 12th grader, all excuse notes should be sent to Ms. Wiggins. Her email address is rayette.wiggins@k12.dc.gov. Or you can send your excuse notes to her cell phone. The number is 202-854-9504. Or you have the opportunity to send your excuse notes via the Remind app. DCPS also has a data lock schedule. And during certain time periods, we will not be able to change any absences inside of Aspen. So please send your excuse notes as soon as you possibly can to avoid us having a hard time or not being able to change it, to be able to change the absence. Next, I would like to discuss SST guidance. An SST is basically a student support plan where the attendance team partners with families to establish rapport and try to remove barriers that are stopping students from coming to school or attending school. After 5 unexcused absences, students are by law referred to the student support team for an attendance intervention conference. And in this conference, is to be held within 5 days of the referral. The SST will develop an action plan in partnership with the student and parent. As for court referrals, this process is the final step by the DCPS attendance intervention protocol. For students ages 14 to 17, The court referral process will take place no later than 2 business days after the accrual of 15 unexcused absences.
Hello, everyone. Let's stay in contact. This is Ms. Douglas, your attendance officer and your POC for Ninth Grade Academy. During our virtual journey, the attendance team would like to make sure that we stay connected as much as we can. To do that, we have created reminder accounts for each grade level. Some of you may have already received a text invite. If you have not, please take the time to jot down a code for your grade level. This is another way for parents and students to have that two-way communications with your attendance POC. One additional way to stay connected is by following the Dunbar Attendance Team on Instagram. You can follow us at Dunbar Attends, and that's DunbarAttends. If you missed it earlier, If you missed it earlier, here are your attendance POCs for each grade level. Ms. Lenore Smith, attendance counselor and POC for 12th grade. Ms. Rayette Wiggins, attendance counselor and POC for upper school, 11th grade. Mr. Donovan Livingston, attendance counselor and POC for 10th grade. Myself, Ms. Rachelle Douglas, attendance officer for 9th grade. Remember, if you are part of lower school, 9th and 10th grade, you can submit your attendance notes and documentation to Mr. Livingston by using the contact information located here, or you can use your grade level reminder account to reach out to him for further information. If you are part of the 11th and 12th grade upper school, you can submit your notes and documentation to Ms. Wiggins using her information located here, or you can use the Remind app to reach out to her for further information as well.
Thank you, everyone, for listening to our presentation. The attendance team is here to support you all possible ways. Please reach out to us. Please follow us on Instagram. And just reach out to your point of contact to say hello. Thank you.
Parents, scholars, welcome. My name is Mr. Rossini. I'm the Pathways Coordinator here at Dunbar High School. I work primarily with our students who are off track, and my goal is to get them back on track towards graduation. And one main way that we do that is through Twilight and credit recovery. Okay, so for our off track students, let's take a look at the road ahead. What exactly is Twilight and credit recovery? Okay, so both programs fall under our evening programming umbrella. Both programs are designed to help our off-track students get back on track. But here's the main difference between Twilight and credit recovery. Twilight is for original credit courses and is based on virtual seat hours, as where credit recovery is for previously attempted and failed courses and is competency-based. Over the next few slides, we're going to take a deeper look into Twilight. Let's start off with Twilight eligibility. Students are eligible to take Twilight 2.0 to recover original credit needed for graduation. Students who received an I in school year 19-20 are also eligible to take Twilight. Students cannot take Twilight to accelerate their learning and graduate early. Again, students cannot take Twilight to accelerate their learning and to graduate early. Twilight scheduling. Same as the day school, Twilight will be offered 4 days a week, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday in 80-minute blocks from 4:10 to 5:30 p.m. Twilight will run in 2-term blocks. For example, if your scholar is taking biology in Twilight, that biology course would start in term 1 and end at the conclusion of term 2. We'll be offering 3 Twilight sessions, right? We'll talk a little bit more about that a little later in the slides. Again, we'll offer 3 Twilight sessions for school year 2021. All right, so now let's take a closer look into credit recovery. Let's start with credit recovery eligibility. All students who attempted and failed the course are eligible to take that course in credit recovery. This includes students who earned an F, as well as students who earned an I during school year 19-20. Credit recovery scheduling. Credit recovery will be offered as an 80-minute period Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday from 4:10 to 5:30 p.m. Students will be enrolled on a rolling basis and complete their course at their own pace. Credit recovery is set to kick off this Monday, September 28th. Again, keep in mind that credit recovery is competency-based, so students do work at their own pace and they complete the course at their own pace. Here's our roadmap to getting back on track. So if you're the parent of a scholar who may be off track, I want you to lock in and focus on these four exits, these four dates, okay? So exit one, September 8th to January 29th is Twilight Session 1. Exit two, this Monday, September 28th, is a kickoff of credit recovery. And again, credit recovery is on a rolling base. So after Monday, we'll be enrolling students on an as-need basis. All right, so let's take a look at exit three. Exit three is from November 9th to April 12th, and that's Twilight Session 2. And let's wrap up with exit four, February 1st to June 24th will be our last and final Twilight Session. All right, so I'm going to leave this slide up for a second because I really want you guys to focus in on these four dates. As a Pathways coordinator, I work extremely close with my students to help them get to the finish line, to help them see the finish line, to help them get towards graduation. That's what it's all about. Our main ways of doing that is through credit recovery and Twilight, but I also want to just check in with them on a weekly basis, sometimes even a daily basis, to make sure that I'm providing the supports that they need so they could be successful, right? I also connect them with different school-based supports and different incentive programs, as well as community resources. So again, the ultimate goal is to get them to the finish line, is to get them to graduate, and we're in it together. That's why I tell my students, we're in it together and we're working towards this goal of graduation together. So I'm always here as a support to support them. To my students, the road ahead may not be easy, but we're in it together. So I'm going to finish off with this. Remember to keep your eyes on the prize, and it's a marathon, not a sprint. And for our school year 2021 motto, the marathon continues.
Members of the counseling team are Ms. Niles, 12th grade school counselor, Ms. Copes, 10th and 11th grade counselor, and Ms. Levine, 9th and 10th grade school counselor.
On this slide, you will find the bell schedule for Mondays, Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays. Note that students have periods 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 on these days. Period 6 is reserved for students who are enrolled in the credit recovery program. Period 1 begins at 9:35. And period 5 ends at 4 p.m. All class periods are 80 minutes long. The first 45 minutes of each class period are direct instruction. The last 35 minutes of the class period is independent study. This is an opportunity for students to work independently or have group work or do whatever it is that the teacher has assigned for that time period. Please note that the lunch for 11th and 12th graders is from 12:25 to 1:10 p.m. For 9th and 10th graders, the lunch period is from 1:50 to 2:35.
Here is an example of a student's schedule. Students are expected to meet with their teachers on Mondays, Tuesdays, Thursdays, and Fridays at the assigned class period. Juniors and seniors have lunch at period 3. Freshmen and sophomores have lunch at period 4. On Wednesdays, students will meet with their TIDES advisory teacher from 1 to 2 p.m. This schedule is different from what you're accustomed to in previous years where we worked on an A-day, B-day schedule. In this circumstance, students are meeting with the teachers regularly and daily, with the exception of Wednesdays. Thus, they will complete the classes faster. Students, instead of taking a year to complete a full credit class, will now take a semester, and students taking half credit classes will now take 9 weeks, or the length of one term.
On this slide, you will find all of the graduation requirements for DCPS high school students. You will see that students are required to have 4 credits in each of the core content areas, including math, English, science, and social studies. Students are also required to have 2 credits of a foreign language, such as Spanish. In addition, students need a half a credit of art and a half a credit of music in order to graduate. Also, students need 2 credits of college and career prep classes. This could mean an advanced placement course or a college preparation or career preparation elective. Students also need 1.5 credits of health and physical education. Finally, students need 3.5 credits of other electives in order to graduate high school. This comes out to a total of 24 credits to graduate.
Promotion by grade level. Students, to be promoted from 9th to 10th grade, you should have earned 6 credits, including English 1. To be promoted from 10th to 11th grade, you should have earned 12 credits, including English 2 and Algebra 1. To be promoted from 11th grade to 12th grade, you should have earned 18 credits, including English 3.
On this slide, you will find the GPA value associated with a regular honors and AP level course. For example, if you receive an A in a regular class, that has a 4.0 GPA attached to it. For an honors level course, it would be a 4.5. For an AP level course, it would be a 5. This same structure applies to grades of a B, C, D, or F. You will notice that honors courses carry a 0.5 additional weight. An AP course carries a 1.0 additional weight. For a grade of an F in a regular class, you will get a GPA of a 0. In an honors, 0.5, and an AP, 1.0. At the end of the school year, for all of your classes, the GPA is averaged out to receive your cumulative GPA.
Here is an example of a student transcript. A transcript is one document of all your final grades. For example, like all of your end of year report cards in one place. In the top left-hand corner, this is where you'll find student demographic information that has been blocked out in this example. Student name, address, phone number, date of birth, graduation date. In the top right-hand corner is the school's information. Dunbar High School, phone number, fax number. In addition, right below that, in the top right-hand corner as well, is where you'll find your cumulative GPA. A cumulative GPA is an average of all of your final grades since you've been in high school. Right beneath that is the class rank. Your rank is where you fall amongst your peers within your grade level. For example, are you the top of your class or the middle of the class amongst freshmen, sophomores, juniors, and seniors? You also have your program of study, which is the DCPS graduation threshold based on the year that you started high school. And lastly, your total number of credits is located in that area as well. How many credits have you earned in total since you've been in high school? In the center of the transcript is where you'll find all your final grades since you've been in high school, starting with your ninth grade year on the left and progressing through your senior year on the right. Below, at the bottom of the transcript, is you'll have your key code of what each course means, and then in the center, our DCPS grading scale. A little bit further to the right is your community service hours. All students are required to have 100 hours of community service in order to graduate, and it will break down how many you've earned thus far and how many are still needed. Lastly, you have a signature line for a school representative to sign your transcript in order to make it official.
Parents can access their student schedules and grades on the Aspen Parent Portal. One of the top five questions about the parent portal is how to access it. The first thing that is needed is a parent email address on file. Hopefully, when the parent registered the student, a parent email address was provided. If not, the parent will just need to contact our school registrar in order to provide their parent email address.
Aspen Tutorial for Parent Portal. The website is aspen.dcps.dc.gov. Parent username is the email address for that parent, and it needs to be in the system. The password, you need to set your own, or your student's counselor can reset the password. Everything you need to know about Aspen Parent Portal can be found by clicking the highlighted word here. Community service. Students should complete 25 hours of community service every school year to remain on track for graduation. In order to graduate from a DCPS comprehensive high school, 100 hours of community service are required. Virtual community service opportunities can be found here by clicking the link below.
Please be sure to participate in parent meetings that are held bi-weekly on Tuesdays. This is where you'll get pertinent information about what's going on in your child's grade level. 9th grade and 11th grade meetings are held every other Tuesday at 5 p.m. 10th grade every other Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. and 12th grade every other Tuesday at 6 p.m. A notification will be sent out in advance to remind you of the meeting. Be on time to get the 411.
Thank you, parents, students, faculty, and staff. Roll Tide.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jason Spinks. I am the Director of Student Life and Athletics at Dunbar High School, and I will be presenting the information pertaining to athletics tonight. I would like to introduce our athletic administration staff, AP Tanya Kabir, Athletic Administrator, Mr. Jason Spinks, myself, Director of Student Life and Athletics, Ms. Tiffany Jackson, Assistant Athletic Director, and Ms. Patricia Besley Cox, the athletic trainer at Dunbar High School as well. The purpose of our program is to provide all students a fun, nurturing, and inviting environment to be successful academically and athletically. Also, to provide the best opportunity for students to excel in teamwork, sportsmanship, leadership, self-discipline, and character. Our 2019-2020 accomplishments. First off, I would like to say that we had an exciting season last year. We had three DCIAA league champions, which were in football, basketball, and indoor track. We also had three DCIAA Player of the Year award winners, and one in football, and then two in indoor track and field, girls and boys. Also, we had 18 all DCIAA team members, football, girls, basketball, boys, and girls track and field. Had 8 DCSAA all-state members from football and girls basketball. We had 4 DCIAA all-tournament members, girls and boys basketball. We had 1 DCIAA Coach of the Year award winner, which was Maurice Vaughn for football. And also Maurice Vaughn was the All-Metro Coach of the Year in football as well. So congratulations to all of those that participated and was a part of athletics in during the 2019-2020 school year. Athletic opportunities at Dunbar High School. We have 19 different athletic sports at Dunbar High School. Co-ed, girls, and boys sports. We have football, JV, boys, basketball, girls basketball, baseball, softball, boys and girls cross country, boys and girls indoor track and field, boys and girls outdoor track and field, volleyball, co-ed tennis, co-ed golf, girls bowling, co-ed cheerleading, co-ed swimming, flag football, and also we have a new sport, which is co-ed wrestling. So if you have any kids that would love to participate in these sports, please make sure that they go through the process of filling out athletic information to participate in these sports. And I'm getting ready to go through that information in a couple of slides. All right, student athletic academic requirements. First off, students have to make sure that they complete the entire athletic participation packet. All right, the entire participation packet is on the DCIAA website. So only thing you have to do is just type in thedcIAA.com, click on athlete, and participation forms will be the first tab on that page. Go through the process of filling out those forms. We will be utilizing Seamless Docs, the same information that you utilize during the summer for registration. Also, you have to make sure that your student athlete has a GPA of 2.0 or higher. If they have anything below a 2.0 during any term, term 1, term 2, term 3, or term 4, they will not be eligible to participate in athletics at Dunbar High School or any DCIAA school until they improve their grades above a 2.0. Also, students must be 18 years of age or younger on August 1st of the current school year. So if your child turns 19 on July 31st, he or she will be ineligible to participate in athletics at Dunbar High School. All right, also, student is enrolled at the school for at least 1 calendar year or has an approved transfer waiver from DCIAA or DCSAA. Students are exempt if they are first year ninth graders. So if they're coming from eighth grade and coming into the school as a first year ninth grader, they do not have to go through the process of a transfer waiver through the state or DCIAA. They're automatically eligible to participate in sport as long as they continue to keep a 2.0. Now, if we have a kid who transfers into the school after their ninth grade year, they will have to go through the process of a transfer waiver process, DCIAA, DCSAA. And you can get that information from the website as well, the DCIAA.com website, or you can get that information from the athletic directors or someone on the administration staff at Dunbar High School, athletic administration staff. All right. Also, please make sure that your student athlete has completed less than 8 semesters in high school. All right. Meaning that they have not went through the process of going through 9th through 12th grade. All right. Also occurred no more than 6 unexcused absences in the current academic term. Now, if your child has missed 6 days and has not turned in a doctor's note or excuse for any of those absences, they would be considered unexcused. So that would add up to 6 unexcused absences, and they would be ineligible to participate in sports until they turn in a excuse for some of those absences or for all of those absences that they occurred. Also, must be present in school on the day of an athletic activity to participate on that day. So if your child or student athlete would like to participate in a sport on a certain day, they have to be in the building. They have to be at school. They can't show up after school and participate in that sport. All right. Requirements prior to participation in interscholastic athletics. This year, we will be utilizing the seamless docs, the same process that you were utilizing for registration during the summer of this upcoming school year. You can find all this information on the DCIAA.com website. All information will be under the athletic or athlete tab on that page. After you click on athlete on that page, underneath that tab, you will see participation forms. You will click on participation form, and you will find all these forms pertaining to athletics. All right, so you will find the DCPS consent for athletic participation, which is the AT13 form. You will find the emergency treatment information form, AT14. And also you will find the physical form, which is called the DC Department of Health Universal Health Certificate form. You need to make sure that that form is signed by the doctor and the athlete and the parent. Also make sure that you and the student, your student athlete fill out the parent and athlete concussion information form, the impact consent form signed by you and your student athlete, and if required, meaning if your child has asthma or if your child is allergic to something, you need to make sure that the doctor, the parent, and the student athlete has filled out the asthma action plan and the anaphylaxis action plan as well. Please stay connected. We have the school website to stay connected with athletics and sports. Also, we have the DCI.com website where we have all the information pertaining to athletics in the district and also our school as well. We have our Twitter accounts, which is at DunbarDC.sports. DunbarDC Sports. And also, we have the Instagram website. So please make sure that you follow us on Twitter and Instagram. Also, if you need more information pertaining to eligibility process, you can go through the process of clearing house and different things of that nature by going to the NCIAA Eligibility Center website. And also, if you need more information pertaining to SAT and ACT tutoring and the dates that you can take the SAT and the ACT to get prepared to go to college, you can go through the collegereadiness.collegeboard.org website, and also you can go to the College and Career Center and talk to Mr. Welch and Mr. Wiley about college and career opportunities. I would like to thank you for allowing me to present this information to you tonight, and please do not hesitate to contact any of us for any information pertaining to athletics from the information that's on this page. We have the AP Athletic Administrator, we have myself, and also we have the Assistant Athletic Director as well. So please make sure that you reach out if you have further questions or you need more information pertaining to athletic. Thank you so much.
We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall overcome someday. Oh, deep in my heart,
in our lives. We all have pain. We all have sorrows. But if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. Please swallow your pride if I have failed. You need to borrow.
Somebody, just call me.
Call me.
Just leave.